better name, Grant. Changing sides here. Let's pray. Lord God, we praise you for your breath. We praise you for your light. We praise you how you thunder in our lives through John the Baptist, through Isaiah. In every way possible, you try to speak to us from that still small voice to that loud voice. You love us so much. We pray that your word may be made anew this night, that we might learn something about you. Learn the hope that we have in Jesus Christ. Amen. Good news. Some of you have checked your Facebook pages out. I sent a little appeal to you to give me top five good news. We're talking about good news tonight. Life is full of good news, right? And so we're going to turn around and talk about what good news is and about sharing hope, the good news of hope tonight. And so here's some of the things that people sent me on Facebook, okay, or email. We're talking about the top five. There's more than this, but this basically was almost all the same. It was almost all the same. I was pregnant, cancer-free, jobs, health, boy, girl, you know, pregnancy. I'm a grandparent. All of them are the same, it seems like to me. There's health, there's children, grandchildren, jobs. Sometimes they mention the spouse, sometimes school. You know, so it goes with the job thing. Only one, though, actually mentioned faith. Now, I assume that when you say children, you're giving thanks to God. I assume you say for your spouse, you're giving thanks to God. I assume because you've been cured of cancer or that you're in a healthy situation, you're giving thanks to God. But no one said that, except at the very bottom, someone said, I can't read it. I don't think, I can't read it, but it says, when Ronnie called me beloved. I call people beloved during worship service. That's from God. That's how Jesus calls us. Not mentioning God, though. Just never mentioned it, seems like that. So the question is how do we react to good news? When we get all this good news, then how are we supposed to react to it? How are we supposed to respond to it? Often the news comes in the midst of really stressful times, don't it? And then we get the good news. And so we need to know how we should act. There should be a way that we react. We should be excited for how we act about good news.
Yeah.
back with good news. We should be excited. This is about the birth of Christ. And this is about the resurrection of Christ. I don't know if you saw that. The alien is Jesus. Resurrected again, going home at the end. There's so much symbolism in movies that you all miss. But this is how we need to react. In the midst of bad news, we need to be able to react with good news. And so today we're going to look at Isaiah, the book of Isaiah. Chapter 61, just briefly. You've got to realize that this is Isaiah is writing in a time that there was really bad news. Now this was written, Isaiah is actually broken up in three different writers, three different books. And this is the third Isaiah. And so it's at the end of their exile. They've been in exile for over a half a century. They've been away from their home. They've been uprooted. And they've heard all these wonderful stories for years and years and years about how great Jerusalem was, how great their homeland was. But they haven't seen it. There's such great glory, but they're living as slaves in a foreign country. And suddenly the king says, well, you know, you all can go back home. You know, and they thought that was good news, but they got used to being slaves. And they said, well, you know, we don't really want to do that. So only a few of them actually went back. When they went back to Jerusalem, it wasn't good news at all. It was devastation. They talked about Jerusalem actually like being a burnt field. There was nothing glory there at all. There was nothing to feel good about. They go all the way back and they heard great things and great joy, and it's really bad news. So Isaiah writes this wonderful passage from Isaiah 61 and talks about the hope, the good news that's coming to them, a hope to a future, a hope of something better, something that we should know about. You know, hope in the midst of desperate and dark times. And so we need to know that we need hope sometimes in our dark times, don't we? I mean, I don't know about you, but my life is not always easy. Anybody here have an easy life? Anybody? Some of you kids, but that's an easy life. Okay, when you start getting at this age, the easy street is over. See, we need hope. The world is a very difficult time. It's a hard time to grow up. And it's dark. And when we're in our desperate straits, we need hope. But so often, people don't want to hear the positive message. So often, when things are bad, they want to stay bad. They want to stay in exile. That's what a lot of our friends want us to do. That's what our families want us to do sometimes, to stay in the same way where it's safe. But we need hope in dark and desperate times.
Hey, who is it? Nice girl. Good place up to Hank Williams or something.
They broke the door down before I could take requests.
Was it weeks in the hall?
Easiest time I ever did. Mr. Mozart,
you can come. So they let you tote that record player down there, huh?
In here. That's the beauty of music. They can't get that for you. Haven't you ever felt that way about music?
I played a mean harmonica as a younger man. Lost interest in it, though. Didn't make much sense in here.
Here's where it makes the most sense. You need it so you don't forget.
Forget?
Forget that there are places in the world that aren't made out of stone, that there's something inside that they can't get to, that they can't touch. It's yours.
What are you talking about?
Hope.
Let me tell you something, my friend. Hope is a dangerous thing. Hope can drive a man insane. He's got no use on the inside. You better get used to that idea. Mike Brookston.
Dear Red, if you're reading this, you've gotten out. And if you've come this far, maybe you're willing to come a little further. You remember the name of the town, don't you?
say what to nail.
I could use a good man to help me get my project on wheels. I'll keep an eye out for you, and the chessboard ready. Remember, Red, hope is a good thing, maybe the best of things, and no good thing ever dies. I will be hoping that this letter finds you, and finds you well. Your friend, Andy.
And release from darkness for the prisoners, to proclaim the year of the Lord's favor and the day of vengeance of our God, to comfort all who mourn and provide for those who grieve in Zion, to bestow on them a crown of beauty instead of ashes, the oil of joy instead of mourning, and a garment of praise instead of a spirit of despair. They will be called oaks of righteousness, a planting of the Lord for the display of his splendor. They will rebuild the ancient ruins and restore the places long devastated. They will renew the ruined cities that have been devastated for generations. Strangers will shepherd your flocks. Foreigners will work your fields and vineyards. And you will be called priests of the Lord. You will be named ministers of our God. You will feed on the wealth of nations, and in their riches you will boast. Instead of your shame, you will receive a double portion, and instead of disgrace, you will rejoice in your inheritance. And so you will inherit a double portion in your land, and everlasting joy will be yours. For I, the Lord, love justice. I hate robbery and wrongdoing. In my faithfulness, I will reward my people and make an everlasting covenant with them. Their descendants will be known among the nations, and their offspring among the peoples. All who see them will acknowledge that they are a people the Lord has blessed. I delight greatly in the Lord. My soul rejoices in my God, for he has clothed me with garments of salvation and arrayed me in a robe of his righteousness. As a bridegroom adorns his head like a priest, and as a bride adorns herself with her jewels. For as the soil makes the sprout come up, and a garden causes seeds to grow, so the Sovereign Lord will make righteousness and praise spring up before all nations.
Good news of hope. If you notice, at the very beginning of this, this is what Jesus proclaimed at the very beginning of his ministry, to bring good news to the poor, release the captives and the blind. This was his mission statement, to bring hope to the world, and you can see that in these things, that bind up in liberty and freedom and comfort, and to provide and to build and to raise up, and we will all be ministers, what he's saying. There will be a new covenant, and that's what gives us hope. In the world of darkness, we need that. Promises are really great. God's promises are phenomenal. But the problem is often hope. in this time. In their lifetime, they never saw that hope fulfilled. So the question is, you know, what do you do when you don't feel like hope is being fulfilled? And I know I've shared a number of times about my past, and I lived in a very difficult time when I was younger. And the interesting thing, I know the time, I wanted to share a few things. My best friend and I talk about this all the time. We both accepted Christ in middle school, and it changed us. It made a difference. It gave us a hope, and none of our other friends had that. And the thing is we look back at those kids we grew up with. One was killed in a robbery when they were doing armed robbery. Another one of my best friends was overdosed on drugs. Two of them went to spit in and out of rehab for drugs and alcohol. The girls got married at 18 and have a gaggle of kids by now. They never left the neighborhood. The list goes on and on. One became homeless and on drugs, and because of his hard living, his heart is working at about 30% now. And Steve and I became Christians. And we didn't have a better family. We didn't have better guidance than they did. The only difference between us and the friends that we had when we were growing up is one and one thing only. It was Jesus. We accepted Christ. And even when I was doing stupid stuff, I had this little thing in my heart that says hope, light, love. And it brought me back all the time. It brought me back to the reality of that God wants something better for me. God needed something better for me. And I think Tim's talked about that too, is that when he accepted Jesus, it doesn't mean he became perfect overnight. It doesn't mean he doesn't do stupid things. And I'm sure Steve is the same way. I mean, if he's a true rock and roller, rock and rollers are known for doing stupid and crazy things. And they can do crazy and stupid things. But when they became Christians, like I became Christians, and if Jesus gets a hold of you, if you truly accept Christ, there gives us hope all the time. And you just can't ever get away. And something keeps drawing you back. And that's what Jesus is all about. That's what Isaiah promises. And Jesus is the fulfillment of that hope. You see, for us, we have it easy. We really do have it easy compared to everybody else. Because we have hope. We always have hope. And that hope's name is Jesus. And we need to remember that in this time of Advent. That's what we're preparing for. The really cool thing about this is that we have this in the Luke passage. Fear not, for behold, I bring you good tidings of great joy, which shall be to all people. For unto you is born this day in the city of David, which is Christ our Lord. And this shall be a sign unto you that you shall find the babe wrapped in swaddling clothes, lying in the manger. That's our hope. That's our hope. And if you don't know Christ, then you're in a world of hurt. Your world is, I mean, marriage is hard. Being on the road is hard. Raising children is hard. Being in college away from home is hard. It's fun, but it's hard, right? And but Jesus will always kind of give you that beacon and that light. And because it's the time of joy, it's the third Advent, and this is joy, a day of joy, I don't want to leave them on such a heavy note. And so when Tim and Steve, I guess, will come up, and we're going to sing, we're going to have a great rendition of Ode to Joy.
Thank you. I've never seen anything like that before.
And with any luck, I'll never see anything like it again.
Oh.
Play it again.
Oh, right.